This talk today is going to be just a little different, I think, than some of the talks that I've done, in part because of good news, and that is that I think that there's a huge upswing of interest in the research community about both fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. It's getting to the point where it's difficult for one person to really understand the field, and that's good. The more scientists and researchers that get involved in the field, the more likely it is that we're going to start to make sense out of these disorders. So what I wanted to do today was, I just picked a few things. This is a selection of what I think are kind of a variety of interesting research advances, but the bulk of my talk today is really going to center on the activity of the Centers for Disease Control and the papers that were published there, which I can barely understand, but I'd like to tell you what I think they mean. And then you'll know more than almost anyone else. First, I just want to remind you about research. Research is a tedious, laborious process if it's done correctly. You don't just make a stab in the dark. You don't just take a guess and think you have the answer. It takes many, many people identifying facts and then creating and testing theories. And it takes a very long time sometimes for the picture to fit together. And it's important to keep, I've talked about this a few times, but it's really important to remember that a fact or an objective piece of information is really quite dependable most of the time. Then what we do is we weave theories around the facts, and sometimes they're not very dependable. They're theories. So you got to live with theories, because we test theories around the facts, and sometimes they change. But that's the process of learning about disorders. So if you think of these puzzle pieces as being small little facts, it's sometimes very confusing and disconnected, and you can't make any sense out of the picture. Some people will start to put a few facts together and think they have the picture, and be pretty adamant about the fact that they think they know everything about the picture. But someone else might take another set of facts and put them together in another way and think they have the whole picture, when in reality the picture is much bigger. And when you put them all together, you have the whole truth. Sometimes we never get the whole truth. Sometimes we function with a limited amount of information. And right now, the state of our knowledge with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia is that maybe this or a step back from this. We have a lot of puzzle pieces to put together and many theories that will fall before we're finished and new theories that will come out. And that includes maybe what we call these diseases, these disorders. So I wanted to review the case definitions with you and get you thinking about how we name these disorders and what it means. This is the CDC research case definition for chronic fatigue syndrome. So if you have greater than 6 months duration of chronic fatigue that limits you functionally, and you've had a good workup that, you know, looking for other underlying illness that might be causing the fatigue, and if you have at least 4 out of those 8 symptoms listed down below, post-exertional malaise, concentration and cognitive complaints, myalgia, which is muscle ache, arthralgia, which is joint ache, sore throat, painful lymph nodes, headaches, new onset headaches with the disorder, and unrefreshing sleep. If you have those things, you meet the CFS case definition. Now, if you're a person in the room that has fibromyalgia, there's a very good chance that you might be captured by this case definition. Does that make sense? So when we use this case definition to go out into the community to study chronic fatigue syndrome, it's not an either-or kind of a situation. If your fibromyalgia gives you this much fatigue and this many limiting symptoms, then you would meet this case definition and you would be included in that study of what we call chronic fatigue syndrome. The other thing to remember is this is a research case definition, and it wasn't really intended as a clinical definition. So it excludes everyone from the definition who has other overlapping conditions that contribute to their fatigue. Well, in real life, we know that that's hardly ever the case, that you can certainly have this condition and many other conditions that compound it. So it's created a little bit of confusion. But the purpose of this case definition is to try to find people to study. And if you want to sort this out, you've got to find people who have a fairly simple presentation of the illness. Now, this is a clinical definition that was published for chronic fatigue syndrome, or myalgic encephalomyelitis, which is ME. It's a little bit different, but it's easier to apply clinically. You still have to have a substantial reduction in activity level due to new onset, persistent fatigue, so it's not fatigue you've had your whole life. You need to have post-exertional malaise. That means when you get up and try to do things or your activity level increases, it causes you to be ill again. Certain symptoms flare back up and limit you. Sleep dysfunction, certain kinds of pain, neurologic cognitive manifestations, and then at least one symptom from two of the following three categories: autonomic nervous system problems, neuroendocrine problems, and immune manifestations. This is a much more workable case definition and encompasses a lot of people. And even though it's called the chronic fatigue syndrome case definition, if you have very severe fibromyalgia and overlapping problems, this would also fold you in. You see how that's the case? So these are not necessarily exclusive definitions. So the fibromyalgia criteria are very broad and don't really require a degree of fatigue per se. This case definition is based on pain and stiffness that is really widespread in the body, involving at least four quadrants of the body, usually involving the spine. And then if you meet tender point criteria on the physical exam, you meet the fibromyalgia criteria. This case definition might encompass up to 6 or 7, 8% of the female population. It's very broad, and many people who are stressed or, you know, undergoing certain stressors in their life, different kinds of stressors, can push into symptoms like fibromyalgia syndrome. And then when they straighten out some of those stressors and get caught up in their sleep, the symptoms might gradually go away. And other people develop very severe symptoms that become progressive and disabling. And many people meet all these case definitions, so they don't really have different disorders. These are descriptive terms that don't really describe why you're sick. It just tries to describe what your illness looks like. So does that help you understand these case definitions better? So really identifying yourself as one or the other is useful only for your insurance purposes or for defining your syndrome or setting up your treatment regimen or describing it to people you know. But this illness often evolves. Sometimes people in their youth get Epstein-Barr virus infection like mono and develop a post-viral fatigue problem that meets the chronic fatigue syndrome case definition. Over time, other things in their life happen to them, and they develop chronic pain, or they look more like someone with fibromyalgia. So these things can also evolve over time. I'm going to skip that slide, and that was a review of what we did last time. So I want to talk about research at the CDC, a press release that was done in April, about 14 papers that were published. Actually, there were more than that, in a journal online called Future Medicine. Well, the company's called Future Medicine, and one of their journals is called Pharmacogenomics. And then many of these papers were also presented at a conference at Duke University. And we'll probably spend more of the time on this. I also want to do a little review about drugs in development for chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. And then I want to talk about a little study we did in our office. And maybe we'll have time for a couple more things. The reason I want to talk about this press release is that I think this is the beginning of an entirely new approach to chronic fatigue syndrome. I think it is the dividing line between people thinking this is not a real illness in the scientific and medical community and having them gradually accept this as a real biological disorder. And I think it's going to trigger a lot more interest in the scientific community in the involvement. So on April 20th, did any of you see, how many saw articles in the paper or something on the radio or on the TV about this press release? So the director of the CDC came out and announced these papers and said that genetic and environmental factors impact chronic fatigue syndrome patients. And Dr. Reeves and Dr. Vernon were two of the doctors who were involved in this research, and those were quotes from them in that press release. That press release went coast to coast, and all the major papers, or many of the major papers, picked this up with articles saying chronic fatigue syndrome has a biological basis. It was very, very important. So these papers came out of a project that the Centers for Disease Control has been working on for some years. In Wichita, Kansas, a big epidemiologic study has been ongoing, and they have a number of patients. So the CDC took 227 patients from the Wichita data, and they put them in the hospital for 2 days and ran every test they could think of on these chronic fatigue syndrome patients. They drew their blood, we'll go through what they did. Then they gave all the data to four teams of scientists and said, take this information and go see what you can learn from it. And this was called the CFS Computational Challenge. They're calling it C3 for short. That's the CDC lingo. And the culmination of these papers are what were published in Pharmacogenomics. And I put down a reference there if you want to go online and look up these papers and read the abstracts. But the papers are not readily available because you need to sign up for the online journal. So it's been very hard for people to get a hold of these papers and actually read them. But I was able to get a hold of these papers from the CFS Association and had a chance to review them, and we're going to talk about them a little bit today. So who are these patients in Wichita? Well, the CDC called 56,000 homes and asked questions about people's fatigue, put them through surveys, then they picked out, they weaned it down to sounding like chronic fatigue syndrome, then they brought them in, they did exams, so they have identified a large number of people who meet the criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome based on that first case definition I told you. Now remember, these could be all kinds of different people, but they meet the case definition. So they went back to this group of patients, and they called back 70 of the chronic fatigue syndrome patients and asked them if they'd like to participate in this two-day hospital stay. They also got, and 58 of them said they would. They also got 59 well people, and 55 controls, 59 people who had fatigue but not quite severe enough to meet the case definition, 27 patients with CFS who also had depression. Now remember, that excludes them from the case definition, but that's kind of artificial. So they said, well, let's look at a group who also has depression and see if we can see if they're different in some way. And then they had that ill-defined group of fatigue who also had depression. And that led to a total of 227 people admitted to the hospital and studied. And here's what they did in the hospital. They collected at least 500 clinical and epidemiologic measures and tested 20,000 gene combinations in these patients with gene array studies. So they took a history of physical orthostatic pressures, blood pressure. They gave them surveys. I've listed them there, SF-36, the one called the MFI, the Epworth Sleepiness Scale. These are all scales to measure fatigue and pain and cognitive dysfunction and depression. They did lab work, routine lab work, and a lot of lab work that we've wondered about in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome, like tests that measure your hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis function. They measured cytokines and new cytokines being studied, such as neuropeptide Y, and gathered all this data, and they also did gene expression profiling. That means they take some white cells, white blood cells out of your blood, and then, I don't know if anybody was here when we did the last talk, but gene expression profiling is a very high-tech way of comparing your cells to known cells to see how they're different. Or taking two groups of patients, chronic fatigue syndrome patients and well patients, and comparing the products of their DNA. And they can do this mathematically now and show whether genes are upregulated or downregulated in comparison to each other. And then it proves objectively that there's something going on with that group. So this is very, very expensive studies, and this was the biggest such study that's ever been done, because it was done more than 200 patients, and every patient had more than 20,000 genes examined against their genes. Now imagine how much data this is. There's no way you could look at this data. Oh, they also did sleep studies. They did two sleep studies. One when they went in the hospital, then they did a test for narcolepsy all day, and then they did a second sleep study on the second night. And they did tilt table testing as well. So then they had so much data, they didn't know what to do with it. So they decided they were gonna give it to these teams. And these teams, each team was made, they're teams of nerds is what they are. Teams of mathematicians and psychologists and computer geeks and biostatistic people and bioengineering people and chemical engineering. And they made the teams, each team had 4 to 6 people. Each person was from a completely different area of science. And there was one CFS clinician on each team. Then they handed them this giant data set and just said, this is a competition. You teams are going to compete against each other, and over the next year, we're going to see what kind of sense you can make out of this giant pile of data. Now remember that the definition of chronic fatigue syndrome, we don't have any lab tests, right? Labs are all normal in chronic fatigue syndrome patients. So they're looking for a needle in a haystack here, when theoretically everything should look normal. And I've gone through what these teams, how they describe them, but it's kind of boring and I couldn't make sense of it. Now, on your handout, I didn't put in your handout all these studies, but I would like to quickly tell you about the studies and just get a flavor for these studies. There's no point in writing them all down or trying to remember them. Just go with me and let me talk to you a little bit about these papers. So the first team had four manuscripts or four papers. In the first paper, what they did is they did mathematical analyses and statistical analyses of this data of 159 of the women. They did principal components analysis and then latent class analysis. And I'm not a mathematician, but what they're looking for is if they can take all this data and throw it in a computer and have the computer sort out how the data cluster together. Does that make sense? And there's many different ways to have that done. And they didn't do anything with the case definitions. They ignored the titles, you know, that the patients had been given about whether they had CFS or depression or whatever they had. And the computer sorted the patients into six groups. Five that were sick and one that was essentially fairly well. So that group, or the class as they called them, and C2 or class number two, 89% of the people that the computer selected were the well group. So the computer was able to sort out at least the well people from those other sick people with pretty good accuracy based on all that data. Because when you have that many people and that much data, the computer can pick up small statistical differences. Now, I'm not sure I'm going to go through all these, but you know, those of us who are clinicians might be able to look at these groups and sense the subsets that we see in our clinic. Like the first group, C1, are people who are overweight and have sleep problems. Hypnoia, I've put it at the bottom, means disturbed sleep patterns and a number of different factors that come into disturbed sleep. It's just a grouping. And they have post-exertional fatigue, and they have objective sleep abnormalities on their sleep studies. Now, when that group was sorted out by the computer and they compared it to their prior diagnosis, half of that group were people with CFS, and half of the group were people with almost CFS. Does that make sense? The indeterminate group who had fatigue. So you can see that the computer can pick out subgroups. We're just not sure what it means. The last group was interesting, C6. This was a group of people who had many symptoms, depression symptoms, they were signs of stress, and they were postmenopausal. And 64% of that group were CFS, but it happened to be a very small group in the numbers. And MD on there is major depression. So the last two groups were where most of the patients with depression sorted out. Now, in their third paper, this first team, then they looked at the gene expression profiles. And that means that instead of looking at the lab tests, they looked at the way the genes sorted out differences among these groups. And it sorted them into two major groups according to the genes. And one group had 32 genes that were different than everybody else, and another group had 26 genes that were different than everybody else. The problem is these groups were combined so that the LCA group 5 had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 groups lumped into it. Those would correspond with that C1 through 6. So what do you make of this? I don't know. It shows that this is a complex group of patients with overlap. There were 17 genes that were pretty much restricted to the well people, meaning it separated the well people from the sick people. Then these are genes that are either upregulated or downregulated, and those were genes that had to do with immune function, transcription, signal transduction, and transport. This has to do with things that happen on the level of producing proteins and the metabolism in your cells. So there are some hints here, but this team didn't come up with too many, but what this gives us is something to look at later about how these genes might make sense. Now the last thing this first team did in their fourth paper was they looked at what are called polymorphisms, and these are kind of spot errors on your DNA, and areas on the DNA that have become associated with different kinds of diseases. For example, sickle cell disease has a known pattern of polymorphism now, and a single nucleotide polymorphism, this is like one spot on that huge DNA, is called, they call it for short, a SNP. And we're doing more and more work with SNPs, which are these single point mutations or changes on the DNA. So this team looked to see if they could find polymorphisms in the group, and they found that when they searched by polymorphisms or by SNPs, their patients sorted into three different groups. One group that had high insulin, high interleukin 6, and abnormal HPA axis dysfunction. I would look at this group as my patients who have metabolic syndrome and fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue. You can't necessarily translate this, but you know, you get a flavor for how the subsets sort out. The second group were people with mood-related neurotransmitter systems, sympathetic drive, and low cortisol. Have you heard the term adrenal exhaustion? So this is the CDC's version of the term adrenal exhaustion. And the third group had neurotransmitter abnormalities, autonomic sympathetic hyperactivity, low cortisol levels, and low sex hormones. So using polymorphisms, the data sorted out quite neatly into three groups. Now, what does this mean? I don't know. It's a different sorting than when you do something else. Okay, we're going to move to team two. So those are the publications of team one. I think it was a little bit confusing, but it is. It gets worse. And that's why I've highlighted some things on here, but some of these things I put in here just for fun. So the first paper of team two, this was a very mathematical group. The first paper tested a certain kind of statistical program called entropy correlation coefficient, just to see if it was consistent with other kinds of statistical programs. And they found that it did pick out very well the patients who had abnormal fatigue scores and depression scores and all those scores on the SF-36 and the CDC symptom index and the cognitive tests. So all the tests the patients were given correlated well with this mathematical computer tool. That's about all that paper told us. So they'll be using that in further calculations. The second paper they did was also very mathematical. I put this in here just to confuse you. Multivariate projection methods used to identify common patterns in clinical and gene expression data sets. So they had 112 patients. They looked at 15,000 genes. Then they applied partial least squares to construct two feature spaces. I didn't understand this at all. Multiplicative scatter corrections followed by quartile normalization was applied for trend removal and range adjustment of microarray data. So they took all this microarray data and applied high-level math and statistics to see if they could make sense out of it. And they found 38 genes that were showed differences between these groups. Only 17 of these genes have been identified and have known function, which is interesting but frustrating. And these genes are genes that are associated with things we know about chronic fatigue syndrome: oxidative stress, immune symptom dysfunction, potassium imbalance, abnormal sympathovagal balance, that's your autonomic nervous system, and reflected in what was called heart rate variability. So that was one of the measures that people with this disease, their heart rate doesn't change very much. Normally people would have a big range of their heart rate, really slow sometimes, really fast when you're exercising, but people with this disease had a lot more of a kind of a monotone of where their heart rate was. So these are values that could only be picked up with these huge statistical programs, but they're definitely the flavor of what we know about chronic fatigue syndrome already. Okay, now the other papers, the third paper done by team three was kind of interesting. They took one test called the multidimensional fatigue inventory. It's like a survey that people fill out that has five dimensions of fatigue. It asks about general fatigue, physical fatigue, mental fatigue, reduced motivation, and reduced activity. Then they looked at the gene expression data, those 20,000 genes, well, they looked at 15,000 in this case, threw it in the computer and found 839 genes that could be analyzed by quantitative trait analysis. This program, 50 to 75% of those genes have no known function. But the ones we do know about have to do with basic cellular functions, energy metabolism, transcriptional regulation, that's taking information from DNA and turning it into proteins and into processes in your body, and cell signaling pathways. So this may seem confusing, and it is, because we don't know very much about the gene yet. We're just starting to understand what these gene products mean, but we're learning little by little to look at the gene, what the gene is telling us, and then start to look at those subsets, and it will lead us to what the physiology of the illness is eventually. That's the whole idea. Are you confused yet? Okay, the third team. See, you can say that you dragged through these papers and no one else will have ever done this. The third team had two papers, and these were, I thought, the least interesting in some ways. They took, well, actually, this one was kind of interesting. The first paper, they took the tired patients, according to the MFI. So this is patients who scored high. This has nothing to do with their diagnosis. It has to do with the scores on their surveys. Does that make sense? So they didn't pay any attention to whether they had CFS or depression or if they were the well people. And they just, they took the tired people and they took the top 10%, the most tired, and the bottom 10%, the least tired, based on that fatigue inventory. So they got the extremes of fatigue. And they did the same thing with the depression scale. They took the highest depression people and the lowest depression people. And then they analyzed and compared the gene profiles against each other. Does that make sense? Again, the top 10% against the bottom 10% of fatigue, and the top 10% of depression against the bottom 10%. And they found 24 genes that were common to both groups, and 11 different pathways. And pathways are interrelated genes that have different systems in the body. And again, look, doesn't you see the common theme? These were genes about immune response, apoptosis, that's programmed cell death, ion channel activity, signal transduction, cell-cell signaling, and regulation of cell growth and neuronal activity. So these are real pieces of information that will lead us to more information about what's going on in these illnesses. But these are strong data because they're not subjective. They're measured. At some point, we'll be able to make sense of them. In the second paper, they applied factor analysis to the whole group. They ignored their case definitions, and they found that the groups sorted into, again, this is a mathematical equation, fatigue, mood disturbance, concentration difficulties, sleep, cognitive disturbances. They made up their own groups. And then they found that it didn't correlate at all with the case definitions and didn't make any sense. That was that paper. Now, team four is the group that got the most attention, I think. Team four, their first paper, basically used complex mathematical comparisons of the clinical data sets. That's all the lab tests and the information that was got that were collected in the hospital. And they did show that they kind of grouped into the CFS patients versus the non-fatigue patients, but unfortunately the numbers were not statistically significant. They have to reach some kind of significance mathematically. But remember, these are normal tests, right? So little teeny shifts may mean something and point us in the right direction. And the values that they found most defining, separating these groups out statistically, were the values that related to depression, heart rate variability, which talked about that, the hematocrit, that's how high your blood count is, MCV is how big your red cells are, waist to hip ratio, that's that apple shape, gaining weight in the middle, BMI is your body mass index, that's how much you weigh, you know, it's your weight. Reaction time, so that's a cognitive test. Cortisol, aldosterone, two thyroid hormones, potassium, sleep problems, urine amount and concentration, and others. But they saw trends about things we already know about chronic fatigue syndrome. They just weren't statistically significant. Now, in their second paper, they introduced a term called allostatic load. And maybe you read that in the paper. That was what everybody caught a hold of. Allostasis is a term that means the maintenance of physiological stability or homeostasis through adaptation to change. So allostasis is the normal state of your body responding to stress and putting itself back together. It's what your body does normally when you're well. Allostatic load is the cumulative wear and tear on the body resulting from chronic or inadequate adaptation to change. And they come up with the term allostatic load by looking and seeing how many little things are wrong with the person and adding them up. Does that make sense? I mean, it's a little bit oversimplified, but they can calculate mathematically that there's something biologically wrong, that the body is deteriorating, by measuring a number of values and then calculating, adding them up and comparing them to well people. That's what allostatic load is. And many of those measures had to do with the stress response system. The HPA axis, and those things were measured as cortisol, DHEA, and aldosterone, and the sympathetic nervous system, which they measured epinephrine and norepinephrine. So So these were the measure they used. And in their paper, they showed that chronic fatigue syndrome patients were twice as likely to have a high allostatic load as normal patients. Now, those numbers, the things they looked at, the 11 components they looked at measures of metabolism, the cardiovascular system, the inflammatory system, the HPA axis, and the sympathetic nervous system. And when they put those variables into the computer and they spit them out, allostatic load, or the measure of things that were wrong in the body and going downhill, were higher in the patients with CFS. And the best markers were waist to hip ratio, aldosterone, which is a hormone from your adrenal gland that helps you maintain a normal sodium and fluid balance in your body, and urinary cortisol. And cortisol is a very important hormone in your body that makes your whole body run correctly. And we, other studies have shown low cortisol levels in chronic fatigue syndrome patients. So this, and then the last paper they published was, they showed that those patients who had a high allostatic load index were closely associated with symptoms. So the more CFS symptoms people had, the higher their allostatic load. So they could, this basically proves the, you know, a biological basis of chronic fatigue syndrome, but they're just clues about what might be going on in the body's process. The last paper that this team did looked at SNPs. Remember those single nucleotide polymorphisms? And they found 28 SNPs out of several million possible SNPs that predicted chronic fatigue syndrome with 76% accuracy. So they really located some SNPs on the genes, some little abnormalities or mutation on those genes that seemed to sort with the patients who had chronic fatigue syndrome. And in this paper, it said part of the computer calculations occupied roughly 2 days of compute time on two gigahertz computers. So the mathematics that went into the manipulation and analysis of this data, it was just staggering. And that was true with all these papers. So this data suggests that there's a genetic component that may explain some aspects of chronic fatigue syndrome. Those are mutations on the genes that have been identified. And I put down what some of the SNPs were, but you know, it doesn't mean anything for those of us who aren't researchers, but neuronal, tryptophan, hydroxylase, nuclear receptor subfamily 3, glucocorticoid receptor, that's cortisol, corticotropin releasing hormone receptor, that's the hormone that tells the adrenal gland to make cortisol, and 5-HTT transporters, this is serotonin systems, and catechol-O-methyltransferase. Anyway, these are very obscure, but there are people who study these. We just need to connect up the geneticists and the people in bench research who understand these and start to do more research on these. So the last thing I want to say about this is, I mean, this hit by storm. These papers were published synchronously in pharmacogenomics, and that people who study gene array data were so excited about this that at Duke, at this CAMDA conference in June, CAMDA stands for Critical Assessment of Microarray Data Analysis, invited the CDC researchers to bring their data, and then they all played with the data. And 10 papers came out of that conference and 3 poster presentations, and they would be just like the ones we just went through. So I'm not going to do that. So what's the bottom line about this? This is my summary of what comes out of these papers. And the event. This is what it matters for all of us. First is, this is the first time that the CDC has formally and finally validated to the public and the research community that the CDC CFS sections work with CFS is valid and that CFS is a real disease. You know, the little group at the CDC who studies CFS is like the ugly stepchild. And everyone has ignored them, and they're sort of low on the totem pole, and they, you know, they aren't very well funded. All these papers came out of a very short period of increased funding to this group, and now the CDC has recognized them and elevated their status, which is going to change a lot of things about how research is done. That was huge. That's political. But to have the director of the CDC come out to the press and announce this is huge, absolutely huge. The second thing that comes out of this is all the teams realized that CFS defines a very heterogeneous group. It's not one thing. It's complicated, and it may be a number of different diagnoses. all the teams found solid statistical support for CFS, the way the case definition is, as a real illness. The other thing that I was happy about is all the data support what we already think we know about CFS, really. It's kind of like, okay, we knew that. Thank you for proving it. But what they did is they've done it with very good population-based data that is hard to argue with now. And the other scientists can take little pieces of and start to figure out pieces of the puzzle. And this is the largest collection of gene array and polymorphism data to date in CFS patients. This creates a very broad base from which other people doing genetic research can start to understand chronic fatigue syndrome better. The other aspect about polymorphism and gene array technology is these are tests that maybe can become a marker for this illness. A marker is so important. In order to identify people, make a diagnosis, even to do research, we need a marker. You can't just have people fill out surveys. It results in what we saw in those papers, big mixed groups of people. So if they can refine this data and come up with markers for subsets, it might just exponentially change the way we understand these illnesses. And the last thing was, although the hospital data only showed mildly abnormal values, which, you know, shouldn't surprise us, right? We know that the tests are normal. The data mining techniques, all those mathematical techniques, yielded some very good statistical clues that are going to point us in the right direction to study the metabolism and the immune system and the parts of the body that may be abnormal in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. So, it seems confusing and complicated, and it is, but it's very important data as a foundation for further research. And people are going to criticize it and argue about it and try to repeat it, and that's good. That's very good science, and that's what's going to happen now. Okay. Maybe enough about that. These other things won't take so long, and we'll have time for questions. Okay, the second part of my talk is, I thought, I want to look and see what drugs are in development for these illnesses. So I went online to this site called clinicaltrials.gov, and you can go there. And it lists all the current, well, it's a little behind because it's the government, but theoretically, it lists all the clinical trials ongoing right now that are approved by approved by the FDA or funded, done by drug companies, so that you can go and see what's being done in these areas. So I put chronic fatigue syndrome in there, and to my surprise, there's hardly anything, really. There's one study in Gulf War veterans about CPAP treatment, that's treatment for sleep apnea, in people with Gulf War syndrome, not chronic fatigue syndrome. And the only other drug study for chronic fatigue syndrome is the study of Ampligen. And I think many of you know Ampligen is the immune-modulating drug that's been studied in CFS, and we get that drug in our office. We're part of the nationwide trial, and that's it, because it's hard to study a syndrome when you don't know what it is. It's hard to develop drugs for it. On the other hand, did I go twice? Yep. Now, I didn't put all this in your handout, but I did put the reference, so you can go here and put fibromyalgia in the search engine. So I put fibromyalgia syndrome in the search engine, and 30 studies came up. And I thought it might be interesting to see what's being done right now to look at fibromyalgia. And it might be kind of small up there. But let me read some of the drugs that are being tested, and you'll be surprised to hear there's not that much new. There's a study of Prozac in kids. Let me just skip down through the drugs. Number three is milnacipran, which is a serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. There's a study of growth hormone in fibromyalgia, and a study of Marinol, which is a marijuana derivative, low-dose hydrocortisone. Remember we talked about low cortisol levels. Keppra is an anti-seizure drug. That's number eight. I couldn't figure out what that number was in number nine. There's another marijuana-like drug, number 11. I'm just skipping through the drugs. And then there's some studies on there of cognitive behavioral therapy, acupuncture, exercise, vagus nerve stimulation. There's some interesting studies going on in fibro, but nothing terribly new. There's number 16 is biofeedback, pain management techniques, non-drug treatment programs. I want to point out pregabalin, which is Lyrica, and which is being studied right now for fibromyalgia. Cymbalta is on the market, duloxetine. Zonegran is an anti-seizure drug that is on the market that we've used a lot in our clinic for management of pain and headaches and sleep. And then I put I made it bigger and put a star by it. If it was one of the clinical trials we've been working on in our office, and maybe Lee would like to talk about that, but this is a safety study of pregabalin, which is Lyrica. This is an anti-seizure drug that we've been participating on through our office and have enrolled patients. Cognitive behavioral therapy, more studies of pregabalin. And the last one down there on the bottom, it isn't listed in there, but there's another trial of it that's going to start of another SNRI called reboxetine. And I looked up reboxetine to see what other studies were being done on this drug, and you can see that there were five other kinds of studies besides fibromyalgia that are being done: a pain study, a post-herpetic neuropathy study, a depression with pain study, urinary incontinence studies. So this drug is being studied for many different purposes. Now let me just review these classes with you, and this should be in your handout. These are the major drug classes of drugs that are being looked at right now to try to modulate symptoms of fibromyalgia. The first class were SNRIs, and that we talked about Cymbalta and milnacipran and reboxetine. These are drugs that work not only by elevating your serotonin levels, but also norepinephrine levels. And we know, because Cymbalta is on the market, that this is a useful drug for some people for modulating pain and their depression. The anticonvulsant class, these were the drugs that were listed in that stack that fall in this class: Lyrica, Zonegran, and Keppra. And we've used both Lyrica and Zonegran in our clinic with good success. The hormones that were on that list were growth hormone and low-dose hydrocortisone. There were two marijuana derivative-like drugs that were being studied to alleviate symptoms of fibro. And then they weren't on the list, but the other drugs that are being studied right now are drugs that are dopamine, that trigger dopamine receptors. And this is a very new area, an interesting area of research for fibro. So I just wanted to say at this time, I'm going to take a little diversion and give you an announcement that, offer has a list of people, a growing list of anybody who's interested in volunteering or being contacted to volunteer for research projects, for clinical drug trials or for other research projects. So if you're interested, you should give your name to Offer. And what Offer's never going to sell your name or send it to somebody. What we would do is Offer would call you and give you the information and give you the chance to contact the study if you're interested. And also, we're going to leave up here, there's a little sign up here that we're going to be, if you're interested in hearing more about either pregabalin or milnacipran or reboxetine, or being a part of those clinical trials, you can call my office. You should put your name on this list and your phone number. And if you want to be contacted when we enroll in these trials and we're looking for people, we'd be happy to call you and see if you qualify. There are some pretty strict restrictions about who can be on clinical trials. Dr. Lee Smith does clinical trials in his office, and many other people. These clinical trials are important because not only do we learn about the drugs, but we're learning about fibromyalgia as we study these drugs. And that's what's been different in the last few years, is drug companies have taken a risk to spend millions of dollars to try to find drugs that work for fibromyalgia. And in doing that, they're going to gather a lot of data, and we're going to learn more and more about the biochemistry of the illness. So the take-home lesson for the drugs in development, first about chronic fatigue syndrome, is we've got a lot of work to do on chronic fatigue syndrome before we can just start testing drugs for it. But drugs under study for fibro right now, they target the central nervous system or the HPA axis, and we've had some progress in symptom management. There's, I think, a very big accomplishment is a huge growing interest in fibromyalgia in the pain community and the pharmaceutical industry. And this is going to move us along in the field. I think it's almost exponential, and fibromyalgia research is way ahead in some ways, at least in this realm, than chronic fatigue syndrome research. Okay, I wanted to talk to you, shift gears. This is a little easier. Your brains can rest a little bit more with this data. I didn't put all of this in your handout because these data haven't been published yet. But I wanted to tell you about this because we had 20 people volunteer in our office to participate in this study, 20 people with chronic fatigue syndrome, and 20 very nice controls, people who were interested in volunteering their body to science even though they didn't have chronic fatigue syndrome, just to come participate in this study. And this study was funded by the CFS Association, and it was done in conjunction with researchers at the University of the Pacific who are specialists in exercise physiology. So we subjected these 40 patients to cardiopulmonary testing. That means they get on a bicycle and they exercise till they're exhausted. And everything is measured, their consumption of oxygen, their production of carbon dioxide, their blood pressure, their pulse, everything, to see what the difference is between CFS patients and just out of shape patients. Does that make sense? Matched about the same age, same, they're all women, so we didn't have confusion about different body types. And to see if we could pick up some differences that could be shown on cardiopulmonary testing, we also did neurocognitive testing. This is a computerized test where they see something and have to type something and respond and test their reaction time. We did that reaction time before exercise, 30 minutes after exercise, and 24 hours after exercise to see if we could show what was going on with patients when you have post-exertional malaise. What happens to you that when you do so much activity, your brain freezes up and you're sick? We also did a survey called SF36. This is a test that tries to, that people answer questions to see how much fatigue and cognitive problems and limitations they have. We did that before and after exercise. And the other thing we did was a test that is thought to be a marker for chronic fatigue syndrome. This is a test of antiviral responses and immune responses called RNA cell. This was a huge, expensive endeavor. We had someone come out and teach us how to prepare the samples, and we drew these before and after exercise. And here's a picture of one of the patients looking like Darth Vader with that gas exchange mask on their face. This is kind of hard to do. So here were some of the results we got from this study. This, in the cardiopulmonary testing, we measure a value called peak oxygen consumption. And that is, that has to do with how much, how it's the metabolism of your body actually consuming oxygen to make your muscles move. And the value for the chronic fatigue syndrome group was 24, and the value for the deconditioned control group was almost 30, 29 to 30. And this is a statistically different number. And actually, we had a pretty robust group of CFS patients. You know, to get someone to come and do an exercise test, it's not your six patients. These were, you know, little higher functioning CFS patients. And so this was an important and reportable number. Because remember that CFS patients are also deconditioned, and these test values may be abnormal because you can't do exercise and you get really out of shape. So it's hard to tell what comes from your CFS and what comes from the deconditioning. This number seems to suggest maybe that there's something more going on physiologically that can be measured by cardiopulmonary testing. And if you look at the normal values in the bottom, you have to do it by age, but both groups fell into the poor or very poor range of outcomes on their oxygen consumption. This is very interesting. This is the reaction time test we did. This test was done, that was that computerized test to test the neurocognitive function. At baseline, 30 minutes after exercise and 24 hours after exercise. If you look at the pink line on the bottom, those are the controls. And you see they got exactly the same score all three times we tested them. But the CFS patients, immediately after exercise, had prolonged reaction time. These were also statistically significant. And the problem stayed around for at least 24 hours, their ability to respond, reaction time on this test. Now, it's hard to know if this is a muscular problem or a cognitive problem, because it takes both things, right? You have to see the computer and think about it and do something with your hand while you're doing the testing. These are very interesting data. The SF36 scores didn't change after exercise. This was a little bit of a surprise for us. And if you look on the left, you'll have the chronic fatigue syndrome patients before exercise. We grouped the scores on this test for physical and mental scores. And on the right are the controls before exercise, the physical and mental scores. You can see how much lower the physical scores are. This is physical functioning of CFS patients compared to very deconditioned controls. They can do much, much less activity. And the mental composite is a little lower, but not a lot. So you know, that may be secondary depression, cognitive changes. And if you look after exercise, 24 hours after exercise, their scores didn't change much. So at least by this measure, the CFS patients had fairly stable scores. But you can see that we picked our groups And these reflect values of all CFS patients nationally and other published data. So this helped us understand that we did a pretty good job of picking out our groups and picking patients who really had CFS to do the study. But we didn't see a change after exercise. Then the most tragic part of this study was we lost all of our RNA samples to shipping error that had to do with something out of our hands. You know, we spent hundreds of hours collecting this data, and it was really expensive, to do these tests. So it was very sad. And that's science, right? We think what happened is they got thawed out somewhere and repackaged en route by FedEx or someone like that. So when they got there to the lab, they couldn't make sense out of the values, and the normal patients were abnormal. Everything was abnormal, so we had to assume that the samples were contaminated. So this study tells us that even young, fairly high-functioning CFS patients have low oxygen consumption as measured on cardiopulmonary testing, supporting the physiologic basis for their illness. And we think that maybe more cardiopulmonary testing will help us understand the physiology of the illness better. We can start to figure out, maybe this could be a marker for illness at some point. I have used it as a disability measure. Do this test and show disability that people are very impaired in their function. This is a test that you can't fake, because there are other measures to show that you actually reach your anaerobic threshold, that you're giving a good effort, that you start to produce lactic acid. So you can tell from the measures that people give a good effort on this test, and yet they're unable to have a normal metabolic response in their body. The slower reaction time, I think, really important data. We'll have to learn more about what that means. And then the SF36 score. So the last thing I wanted to say, a couple things before we take questions. I'm really excited because there's a group of researchers up at the university now who are very devoted and interested in research on fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. This is a very new thing. Most of my career, I haven't been able to generate much interest among any of the people up at the university. Now, this is changing. These researchers came in from a different place. They moved here from North Carolina, and they brought with them their experience studying mechanisms that relate to fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. There's now a group of collaborative researchers at the university. It's what's called the Pain Research Center, where it's a think tank of how to do research to understand these illnesses. There's a geneticist from the Huntsman Cancer Center. There's a specialist in the autonomic nervous system. There's a brilliant researcher who studies animal models and receptors of pain and fatigue. This group is going to start recruiting for some studies, and there's a study they're about to do that we're looking for some both CFS and fibro patients. It's an exercise study. Alan Light, who is the bench researcher, thinks he has a marker, a new marker that no one has ever studied in humans that might explain pain and fatigue in humans. It's a cell receptor that he has pioneered in his research. So we're going to measure these receptors in patients before and after exercise, among some other variables. On this last page, there was a conference in Barcelona devoted to research of HHV 6 and 7, which is a virus that's long been implicated as a potential cause for chronic fatigue syndrome, just like Epstein-Barr virus has. And at that conference, you might want to go to that website and look at some of those papers, because they've had some very interesting success measuring active virus in certain patients and trying to treat them with antiviral drugs. And Dan Peterson, who is in Nevada, feels that maybe patients with a long-standing active viral infection may be at risk for lymphoma, and has some very unusual data. You may know that my sister had gotten non-Hodgkin's lymphoma after she had chronic fatigue syndrome, so maybe some of this viral research will lead to more information about how viruses can alter your genetic makeup and sometimes lead to that kind of progression. Now, that would be a very unusual thing. Probably even HHV6 would not be the cause of all cases of chronic fatigue syndrome, just some subsets. Okay, let's take some questions.
Last week, about some research that shows a strong correlation between a virus, and I think it was related to a flu virus, and chronic fatigue syndrome. Have you seen that, and what are your thoughts on that?
I didn't see that exact article, but my instinct is, and a lot of the data suggests, that many different viruses could probably create a syndrome like chronic fatigue syndrome. There was a study in Australia that looked at four different infectious agents, and 10% of people who got those infections went on to develop chronic fatigue syndrome. And that number's held pretty true with studies of other viruses. When the most common, I thought, well, maybe it's the people who were stressed, or maybe it was the people who, you know, had this or that. And they looked at a lot of different risk factors. And the most suggestive risk factor was just how sick they got when they were first ill. So maybe how severe the initial infection was really determines whether or not people have more of a permanent disability related to that viral infection. So you see things pop up relating to different viruses. The problem is we don't have very good tests for viruses, and we don't have very good drugs for them. So it's not that readily available in a clinical situation. You can't just say, send me a viral panel. And it's kind of like looking for a needle in a haystack. And then even if we find something, knowing how to treat it has not been studied very well. So that's what's hindering us along those lines. We need more of that research and better objective markers to know how to look for it.
Who is writing the request to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to give money for a grant? Who's writing the grant?
You know, that's a very good question. Let me talk to you a little bit about grants. It's something authors thought about. First of all, the Gates Foundation actually has an emphasis toward children and big preventive programs. So, I mean, it's a good question, and we've actually thought through this. The other thing is that grants are competitive. They sometimes require a great deal of expertise and time to write competitive grants. Sometimes it takes a long time to get submitted, and the majority are rejected. But and grants are given to nonprofits and to academic institutions, and you know, people with big research departments and grant writers have a better competitive edge to get grants. But you know, if anybody has ideas or connections, those kind of grants might be helpful. And most major funding either comes from federal money or from pharmaceutical companies. And it would take a huge commitment from someone like Gates to have the amount of money that would be needed to do this kind of research. So keep your ears open for kids, you know, of rich parents with these disorders. Maybe you can get funding.
I have a couple other questions. This is the first time I've had fibromyalgia for a number of years, and this is the first time that I've ever heard the pituitary gland problems and low testosterone, because I had been diagnosed with pituitary adenoma that they've been tracking for the last year and a half, and low testosterone. I'm wondering if there's any connection with high cholesterol that you've heard about.
You know, in my experience, just anecdotally, it's common, especially in my male population. There are two populations of people, and maybe three, that I see develop fibro symptoms. One are people with hormonal issues, and another would be people with, what was I going to say? I lost my train of thought. But a metabolic syndrome, which is actually a hormonal issue. That's why I kind of got stuck. But I think that there may be an association. Knowing the chicken and the egg is a little bit difficult. But I think if I pulled my data out of male patients in my clinic with fibro, a huge number of them would have metabolic syndrome. And whether or not that comes from being inactive and gaining weight from the medicines, or whether or not it's the thing that predisposes you to developing chronic pain and fatigue, it's not really clear. But those are important questions to ask at some point.
One other question. What is the correlation or the relationship between CFS and fibromyalgia?
Well,
how are they linked together?
It's hard to explain. I wouldn't think of them as two discrete entities. But think of the case definition as defining a group based on their symptoms. So fibromyalgia picks out people who have chronic pain and stiffness as their primary problem and tender points. And then we know that what travels with that may be a certain degree of fatigue. But if you take all people with fibromyalgia, there's a big spectrum of how much their function is affected by fatigue. Does that make sense? There are a lot of fibro patients who can go, they're miserable, but they can go to work every day and carry out a pretty vigorous schedule. And on the other end, there are people with fibro who have so much stability from their fatigue, they're like a chronic fatigue syndrome patient, is the main limiting factor is really their inability to do things and to function. And whether that's part of their pain or a bigger process because of meeting both those case definitions is hard to say. The case definitions are just descriptors. They're grouping descriptions. So I wouldn't get too hung up on it. How you use these case definitions is what matters. If you're going to go out into the population and study a group of people, you use your case definition, you're going to gather a certain group of people together. And if you use the fibro case definition, you're going to gather a different group of people than if you use the CFS case definition. But there will be a lot of overlap. There will be some people who would end up in both groups. I don't know if that helps.
I have hit the jackpot. I have the chronic fatigue, the fibromyalgia, the irritable bowel syndrome, whatever else goes with it. And now I'm on a CPAP machine for the sleep apnea. Does that go along with this?
It definitely does. And that's why, a few years ago, I think some people would have thought it was heresy to say that these terms, you know, that we shouldn't stick to these terms. But I think the more we know about sleep problems and pain and fatigue, and the more we tease apart these groups, the more these case definition terms are going to sort of go out of date. Because we know the autonomic dysfunction brings on irritable bowel and bladder problems and blood pressure and pulse problems, that heart rate variability problem. And the hormonal, this complex hormonal system of the hypothalamus, pituitary, and adrenal axis, which affects your thyroid and the whole functioning of your body, is a bit dysregulated. It's just that we don't understand it yet. So as we, and the most important thing to remember is there's probably not one disorder. There's probably several groups we've got to sort out and start to look at them individually. And then you have overlapping issues of other medical problems and mood symptoms and your own genetic makeup and many things that make this a complicated kind of detective work to figure out.
Well, they say in this that you stop breathing on this sleep apnea.
Yep.
Well, during the day now, I have a hard time breathing because I keep taking deep breaths like during the day. And I wonder, can you have that in the daytime too?
It's probably not true sleep apnea, but dysregulation of the rhythm of your breathing or how tight your chest muscles are contracting and a lot of other variables may certainly affect your breathing during the day. Probably not of the same severity as what happens when you're asleep because you're not awake to guard your breathing.
Maybe you just answered this, but what are some of the dysfunctions of the autonomic nervous system?
Yeah, it is broad, and those are some of them. The autonomic nervous system controls your breathing, your heart, your blood pressure, the tone of your blood vessels. It controls sweating, controls how your eyes focus. If you knew all of them, you would have a little bit of a symptom in almost every area, probably, because there's a little dysregulation, and it's a good part of the symptomatology. It's not very severe in most patients. It's just bothersome. And it gives you a lot of symptoms. And the autonomic nervous system is run by chemicals that then trigger receptors that are spread out in different patterns all through your body. And so where those receptors are determines how the chemicals turn on that area of your body. It might constrict or dilate or speed up or slow down your heart or have many different functions depending on where those receptors are in your body when those chemicals get kicked out by your adrenal gland.
But my question is, what's your take on the correlation between breathing problems such as asthma? I have exercise-induced asthma and fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue, and I guess how you raise your VO2 consumption.
Oh, good question. Those are all complicated questions. I'll just say that I think anxiety does play an important role in that sensation of not being able to expand your chest, but it may be more complicated than just anxiety, because anxiety ties in with your autonomic nervous system, and it's possible that it's more neurologic than psychological, but it really feeds on itself. And so I try not to focus too much on the why, but focus on what it might be and see if you could modulate it and control it. And that was just my comment about that. The studies of chronic fatigue syndrome have always had an element of immune dysfunction. And one of those, early in the course of illness, people tend to have problems with antiviral mechanisms and seem to get sick a lot and have viral symptoms. Later on in the illness, there tends to be kind of a shift in the immune problems that are more an upregulation of antibody systems, including allergic responses, kind of nonspecific allergic responses, and a little bit more like an autoimmune type process where antibodies are formed and the body is a bit dysregulated in that way. So There's one part that says maybe it's an outcome of chronic fatigue syndrome. The other thing is, in the histories that we've taken, very, very often patients in our clinic have had allergies and sensitivities all their life before they developed chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia. Now, whether that's a direct relationship there or whether it's just common to have allergies, I don't know. But that's something we have to study. Certainly, from the treatment standpoint, you don't always have to know why. You just have to know it's there and sort of address each thing that's there and try to bring it into good control. The why is really for scientists to answer eventually, and hopefully we'll be able to do that better over time.
Do you have any articles to recommend on what you were just talking about the viral element?
And there's a huge literature about the viral element. I would caution you and say, if I could generalize, I would say that it's difficult to know what viruses could be involved. And if you can identify one, you should try to treat it. But that's a challenge, because identifying it is one thing, especially if it's a latent virus. Let's say it's a, you know how herpes causes cold sores. Well, in between outbreaks, it's very hard to identify that herpes is still in your body if it's not outbreaking. It's hard to know where to go find it. It lives in ganglion cells in your nervous system, and you can't measure it except when you get a cold sore and it's, you know, making new viruses. So trying to find viruses that are in a more latent form is very challenging.
That's exactly what I think I have. It's when I get sick, it's so often the same. I think it's the same thing sitting in there that I turn on and off.
Yep. Oh, I'm going to tell you that feels that way, and it might be true, but it doesn't have to be true, because there are other reasons that can cause that, including an immune response. A broken record immune response feels just like an infection. So you really know you have an infection, because most of the symptoms of an infection are really your immune system causing the symptoms. Your immune system coming out to fight the infection is really what gives you the aches and the fever and the symptoms. It's all an immune response. So it is complicated, and you're right, though, that patients tend to have a little fingerprint of, I call it their fingerprint of their symptoms, and everybody seems to have their own individual pattern, and when it comes back, it's your fingerprint that recurs. Now, why that happens, we're not 100% sure, but that's definitely the pattern, but it's different for different people. So that's what makes it challenging. It may be that a different infectious organism caused it, or it injured a different part of your body, or there's a different kind of immune response. Those questions have never really been answered fully.
All of your discussions have been on treatment. Do you have any discussions on prevention?
You know, that's a good question. Nobody knows for sure. My instinct is, and I think many people who study both fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome, is, and we're going to design our whole conference around this next year, the provider conference, there may be certain people who are predisposed to developing this problem with some kind of genetic weakness, a little bit of something in the gene waiting to be awakened. We know there's a little bit of genetic component. I think it's quite clear that for most people, the onset occurs in a period of stress. Everybody knows that. You know, you're on overdrive. You've been doing too much. You've been missing sleep, you know, things. It does not mean that you're weak or that you didn't handle the stress well. Just cumulative stress and wear and tear on the body sets people up in some way for the onset of this illness. Then certain things happen that tend to cause injury. And that's what the CDC was saying with these studies, is that the body's ability to recover from these injuries is abnormal. And instead of coming back to normal, they add up. And each thing that happens adds a new dimension of illness to this person who has an impaired ability to recover. And why that happens, we're not sure, and it might happen a little differently in each person. Those are important clues. So back to the question of prevention, you know, you can't prevent every stress from happening in your life. But you know what? All of you who are sick, you've had to dramatically change your lives, right? The illness has forced you to change your life. Well, if we could identify somehow people who might be more prone to this, and, you know, teach them to have a more paced life and to rest and to give their bodies recovery time, maybe those things that happen to them wouldn't be as devastating and as illness-provoking. I think that's probably true. It's just hard to know. But I do know that untreated sleep problems, untreated anxiety, untreated driving type A personality without letting your body rest, all kinds of things probably set us up for getting ill. Why it happens to some people instead of others, I don't know. Why some people get away with it, I don't know. Those questions haven't been answered.
Are there studies that go with Go along with certain co-presenters, as he said.
We have a sense of that as clinicians. You know, many things can go wrong with your body. If you think about that concept of allostatic load, what that's trying to say is the body does not recover from normal things. So lots of things can happen, and so you have to stay alert and pay attention to what's not doing well with your body and just stay on top of it. And so we see these comorbid conditions that occur frequently, but how exactly to link them, we're not sure. But, you know, from a clinical standpoint, that's why you have someone who follows you, and you check out your symptoms, and you do your healthcare maintenance, and you take the best care of yourself that you can. And that's about the best we can do for now. There are many other illnesses like this, you know, where people have to just cope with a difficult problem, readjust their life, and take care of a chronic illness the best they can. This is just particularly frustrating because it doesn't have as, you know, good as maybe the identifiers and the name are not as good. But the process is very similar for other kinds of chronic illness.
The word immune system comes often. Wouldn't we be smart to work on our immune system to whatever you do?
That's exactly right. But how to work on the immune system is equally indirect. And that's why we try to restore sleep and reduce stress. And, you know, it's hard to directly fix your immune system. You have to indirectly fix it. A lot of things in your body normalize when you have normal sleep patterns and when your stress levels go down. And then whatever we can do to improve our immune system, we should do. It's just a very complex system that's not always easy to fix.
Where can we find out? We're
working on it.
A library book? No. How to build your immune system, something things.
You'll hear lots of advice, but you better weigh it out carefully. The more simple someone makes it sound, probably the less they know.
Because anxiety has been mentioned several times, do perfectionist-type people get these things also?
Yeah, definitely. That can be a source of stress that makes it so that your body doesn't get a chance to rest and recover.
Don't sweat the small stuff, and it's all small stuff.
Exactly.
Right.
Downsizing and downpacing is very good advice for all of us.
I just had a question about the drug list you had. I'm assuming that each of those drugs are chipping away at one of the numerous symptoms. There's probably not a drug that they've looked at that, like, is fibromyalgia drug.
Exactly.
Just the symptoms.
Well, yes and no. I think we're getting closer and closer to central mechanisms, and that's what Dr. Smith is an expert in. But there, as we learn how these drugs work, you start to make associations for how they relate to each other, and eventually we're going to understand the mechanisms better, especially fibromyalgia, which is a very serious dysregulation of central pain and sensory mechanisms, and tied into neurotransmitters and sleep and all kinds of things, and the HPA axis as well.
In terms of the neurotransmitters, and I have a concern, which is, and that I'm hoping that maybe you can tell me if you're seeing it in the scientific community, if you're worried about it becoming an issue, and that is, if we identify the different neurotransmitters and we say, and we're looking to have people to respond to them as a group, as opposed to that some adjustment to a neurotransmitter here and a neurotransmitter there may be effective, but others may actually lead to almost worse effects.
Right.
And my concern is that the neurotransmitters are going to get grouped together, and it's going to either be that because you respond to all of them as a group, then you must be a fibromyalgia patient, and if you don't, then you're not. So that's a piece of the concern. The second piece has to do with this identification of some kind of marker. And again, the same concern is that it seems to me we may be looking at the possibility of multiple markers.
Mm-hmm.
And when I hear that we might be close to identifying a marker, I start to panic because it feels like, oh my gosh, it took this long to get people to take me seriously. And what if I didn't have that marker?
I mean, those are all valid concerns. But it's not going to change the outcome. And here's the way I look at markers and subsets. You know, I've talked to a lot of groups that get very angry about broadening who we look at. Like, there are people who are very strong advocates for CFS research that don't want any money shared with other kinds of chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia for fear that it will dilute what's needed for this group, and that my process is entirely different. I want to spread a broad net and gradually figure everything out, and it will take this group, and they'll get, you know, somebody's going to get first marker, but that doesn't make the leftovers any less important. You just have to keep plugging away at it. It's just frustrating, but it's still the process. So the more inclusive we are, the better off we'll be. I think if we're exclusive, definitely, that's what leaves people out. But this is such a heterogeneous group, no matter what you do, you're going to leave someone out. So I think casting a wide net and including everybody who has ill-defined symptoms that don't have another name under one umbrella, continue to study people, and then we'll be peeling off groups who get markers. We'll start understanding certain groups better. They'll go off, they'll get a different name, and we'll keep working until the pool gets smaller and smaller and smaller until we get everybody figured out. Does that make sense? So it's frustrating, but it isn't going to happen all at once. It's going to happen a little at a time, and that's the nature of science. So somebody's going to say, I'm going to study this subgroup, and all of a sudden they're going to hit on something, and all the attention is going to go over there, and just going to have to be patient. And all of us who study the illness are going to know that there's a lot more people that need to be studied, and that's unfortunately just the way it's going to be.
You mentioned using pregabalin in your practice with having success with that. It's the first time I've heard about that. Is it for chronic fatigue or fibromyalgia, and what specifically is it treating? Pain, fatigue, what?
Lyrica is the other name for it. It's been on the market. It isn't approved yet for fibro, but the studies are ongoing, but it is available, so you know a lot of people have tried it. And I see it more effective for fibro symptoms, pain and sleep symptoms. Although, you know what? I'm always surprised. I have someone come in, I had someone come in today who's on 75 milligrams, which is a real tiny amount. She has very classic CFS, and she feels a lot better. She just takes it at night, and she couldn't really describe to me how she felt better. She just was doing more. And it was a shock to me because, you know, lots of people don't tolerate the drug. This is, you know, what the person in the dark was referring to is there is a huge variety of how of neurotransmitter response and the complexity of neurotransmitters, and you do have to individualize treatment to the given person. So you try things out until you find something that fits. And every drug that we use, I have a spectrum of people who think it's the best thing that was ever invented to the worst thing that was ever invented for every single drug. So I'm not going to throw it out the window. I'm going to keep trying to individualize my treatment until I get as many people it's perfect for as possible, and we'll keep working with the ones that it doesn't work for. And that's the way it's got to be for a while until we have better and better ways of sorting out subsets and predicting who's going to respond to which drug.
Thank you.